Krishna Krishnaya Bhutaleya Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamina
Iti Shanti Namo Krishna Padaya Krishna Krishnaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta
Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shankaravani Hastatatisha Hari
Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani
Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Advaita Gadadhar Jiva Sati
Jaya 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 Ja
Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna, Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Rama Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama,
Hare Rama,
Rama Rama,
So proud of the kirtan. It grows every year. Isn't that so fabulous? Derek Rai was there, and also football. And so packed people. And there was some, they wanted us to kind of tone it down. We went for a long time, and we weren't creating any trouble whatsoever. In fact, the chanting creates a real moderating effect. And the police were just concerned about some of the young men, not ours, but from our part of the world, India, you know. They were up on some monument dancing, and they thought it was a little disrespectful. They kept at it for a while. Anyways, I walked with Ravi back to the temple. I was, you know, we were practicing for our drama, so many people, and we were at Lajpat Prashe's program the next day. And whenever you go to their program, it's like people, there's just people. I just want to get away from people. I didn't want to go to the subway or anything, so I decided to walk back to the temple with Ravi. And there was one fellow, you know, in near Yangon College where we were walking, and he put his body out the window. He's a passenger in the back seat. And he said, he gave a real loud, "Happy New Year!" He yelled it out like that. And, you know, he was saying that to myself, and a few people were walking, pedestrians, and nobody responded. I said, "You're all boring! You all suck!" Because nobody said anything. After he said that, then we all laughed. And he got us excited. It's true, you know. It's true that sometimes people don't respond to this. Anyways, it was funny. We had such a good time. We could have outgrown ourselves. Like, our speakers aren't big enough, they're not loud enough. Everyone gets all hyped up to the point where you can't even hear yourself chanting anymore. No, it's really difficult. Anyways, thank you for coming. Happy New Year. And we are happy to be here in this new home on the street, Trentonian. Number 22. How do you call it on the water? Happy New Year. Everything's complete when you were here. And Anandamayi. Did Hiten come?
Yes, Maharaj.
Oh, good. Well, we could just, did he bring the Mridanga with him?
Mridanga is there. There's a non-Mridanga.
Okay, well, maybe we could use his help after a while. Good. And so we're very happy to be here in this part of the neck of the woods as a part of the urban sprawl dynamic. I don't know how, personally, I don't know how I feel about farmers' lands being eaten up by all of us. Chewed up. It seems to be the way the world is going. I just wanted to read a little excerpt from Ocean of Mercy. This is a book that just came out by Bhakti Chiru Maharaj and to my dear godfather and friend Bhaktimarg Swami. Personally autographed. Isn't that nice? Okay, this is where I'm at. I'm near the end, page 213. Chapter's entitled Back Home. And there's just a few pages left. I hope you're all having a good time. I heard Brampton had a smashing time with the New Year's.
Yes,
and the Scarborough devotees also. But now we're getting crowded, as usual.
Yeah, everybody can move.
Can we kick the face this way?
Please, everybody come in here. Listen to Maharaj.
Well,
come.
I get everybody's attention, that'd be nice. I don't come here very often, so we'd like to make it a big night in this house. It's our first time. We hope to come many more times. Thank you, Bhagavat and Krishna Swaranam, for making this space sacred. This is the last days with Prabhupada. I felt helpless. Srila Prabhupada's condition was critical, but there was nothing we could do to help this valuable teacher, Maharaj. He was emphatic that the best medicine was the holy name, and that we should pray to Krishna and depend upon him. What he was going through, he reminded us, would happen to all of us. I began to understand that through his own example, Srila Prabhupada was teaching us how to prepare ourselves to leave our bodies. Bhishma, that's Prabhupada's sister, had come to Vrindavan to see Srila Prabhupada and stood by his side by his bed, with love pouring from her eyes. So we're in Vrindavan, 1977. Ask her when she came, Prabhupada told me, although she was just a few feet away and could hear what he was saying, he did not want to speak to her directly. Tell him that I came this morning with my son Chandra, she replied. Ask her where she is staying. In Goswami Maharaj's mat in Imli Tala, she said, referring to Srila Prabhupada's godbrother, from whom her son had accepted initiation. Why she is staying there? Why she is not staying here? My son took me there. Prabhupada suggested that they move to our guest house, and she agreed. Ask her whether she would like to cook for me. Ask him what he would like to eat, she replied. Tell her that she can cook whatever she would like to cook. But Bhishma wanted to know what Srila Prabhupada wanted. Finally, he told me that she could cook khichdi. Maybe that's what we should have for Rathia. Okay. She walked straight to the kitchen with me following behind. When Kirtananda heard that Bhishma was cooking for Srila Prabhupada, he became concerned and tried to persuade him not to eat her cooking. It would be too heavy and spicy, he said, not suitable for his condition. But Prabhupada explained that he was accepting Bhishma's cooking just to please her. She wanted to cook for him. She always loved to cook for him, and he wanted to give her the opportunity. Kirtananda was adamant and argued his point repeatedly, but Srila Prabhupada said, I am already a dead man. If I die eating or starving, it doesn't really matter. When I informed Srila Prabhupada that the prasad was ready, Kirtananda told him, Prabhupada, you are not going to eat that. Prabhupada's voice became sharp, the first time I had heard him speak that way, and he told Kirtananda, why are you doing this to me? Do you think that I do not know what I should do and should not do? Don't ever think that you know better than your spiritual master. Kirtananda was devastated. He just walked out of the room, and that evening he left Vrindavan. I brought the plate, beautifully decorated with various preparations. Sitting up in bed, Prabhupada honored the prasad, barely eating anything, but just tasting one item after another. We were still worried about his digestion. He had not had any solid food for days, but he did not have any problems. When I told Bhishma about the devotee's concerns, she replied just as she had when Tamal Krishna Maharaj had expressed his concern about Prabhupada's eating kachoris and samosas. If Prabhupada wants, he can digest even stones. This reminds me, most of you have gone to Mayapur and at the Pushpa Samadhi, you know where that is? Mm-hmm. It's that beautiful circular building. In my opinion, it's the best building on the campus. It's even better looking than the POVP. No offense to everybody here. I spend most of my time in Mayapur in that building, in the Samadhi and so on. There's a car parked out there. And they recently refurbished it. They souped it up. And Yadubar, the filmmaker, he told me, oh, I drove that car. I drove Prabhupada around in Delhi. I says, why did you drive him around? We were looking for a kachori store. You know, like one that Prabhupada liked, you know, a kachori place. Mm. And so what happens is, well, we never did find it. It moved somewhere. So Prabhupada had his softness towards kachoris especially. After Kirtananda's departure, I resumed my cooking duties. But by this point, Srila Prabhupada was hardly eating and his health continued to decline. Nevertheless, I cooked for him every day, hoping that his appetite would eventually return. One day he said, "You have so many things to do. Why are you wasting your time cooking when you can see that I don't have any appetite and I'm not able to eat anything?" Srila Prabhupada replied, "I cook hoping that you will get well and develop some appetite and eat something." He said, "I will get well only when I die." That's my remark. Hearing that, I could no longer control myself. I broke down in tears. Srila Prabhupada soothed me like a father. "Is this what you learned from me?" he asked. "Didn't I teach you that the spirit soul never dies? The spirit soul simply changes the body. It transmigrates from one body to another." He was reminding me that he would always be there with us, even if we could not see him. Although Prabhupada was not eating, he was concerned about the quality of the devotees' prasad. So he sent me to investigate. When I reported that the quality was not very high, he sent for the temple president and directed that the standard be improved. "Make sure the devotees get nice prasad," he told me after the temple president had left. "It is the only sense gratification they have." And one time Srila Prabhupada was talking to Garga Muni, his disciple, said, "If there isn't good prasadam, then life isn't much worth it." He was having good quality food. That we must know. Are we doing okay? Mm-hmm. A little bit more?
Yes.
It's new stuff. Just came out hot off the press. Even in the midst of Srila Prabhupada's health crisis, his society continued to move forward. He had constructed a building next to the temple for the Gurukul, and its inauguration was planned to coincide with a 3-day conference on science and religion organized by Swarup Damodar and sponsored by the Bhaktivedanta Institute, short for BI. Okay. Prabhupada had seen how, in the name of science, the world was being misled and the existence of God denied. The root of the misconception was the claim that life evolved from matter out of some random chemical combination. And he wanted it proven that life came only from life. He also wanted to show that Krishna consciousness was not just some blind faith, but was the science that could be objectively perceived and experimentally verified, which is why he had established the institute. He had asked several GBCs and sannyasis to give their full support to the conference and charged Bhavananda Maharaj with assuring that the guests were treated with the utmost care and attention and given first-class accommodations, and especially first-class prasad. Okay, then 50 prominent scholars and scientists have been invited, including the chair of the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, who would give the opening address, representing ISKCON, where Madhavadas, that's Dr. Michael Marchetti, Sadaputa Das, Dr. Richard Thompson, and Swarup Damodar, who's seeing Dr. Singh. On the advice of Tamal Krishna Maharaj, each lecture was followed by a response by one of our devotee scientists, and then the audience was invited to ask questions. At the end of the 3-day program, there was a press conference drawing reporters from as far as Delhi, and all India radio broadcast it nationwide. And then it goes on. Chuck. I haven't finished reading this myself, this is all fresh material for me. But I just thought that everywhere, this is like a sugarcane slab, you know, where every bite it's sweet. And that's because it's all about Prabhupada. So thank you very much for listening. And as Bhakti Chir Maharaj, the author, explains here, that while Prabhupada's health was failing, things had to go on. You know, the push, the Sankirtan spirit had to move forward. You know, this is a move forward directive movement. You know, we keep going ahead. Yeah, we have some low periods, like, you know, somebody major passes away. We have to go through our mourning, just like Fidel Castro passed away, and we were happened to be there, and just happened to be there. I had an insomnia attack, and I slept, and the Maharaj was in the room, and he said, "Maharaj, did you hear the news?" I said, "What news?" And they said, "Fidel passed away." And I just, you know, I had to doubt it like anything. I said, "How could that be? We're here just for a few days, and during our time, he's passing away. Are you sure?" So, you know, it did happen like that, and 9 days of mourning. But of course, life still goes on. We were at the resort, people are fed. But no music. We couldn't play any. Dirig Roy was there. We brought him over to be the musical guy, and Mr. Music couldn't do any music. But I think you liked it anyways.
Yeah, sure.
Cuba, the devotees in Cuba are very sweet. They're very nice. I was speaking to Peter Burwash yesterday, the, you know, motivational speaker. He asked, what's it like over there, you know, the people. I said, they're Latino folks. They're very warm-blooded people. Their bhakti comes natural to them. You know, it's easy. You just present bhakti, devotion, and they understand it. It's comprehensible to them. There isn't the suspicion, you know, and, you know, these people, most people are pretty well read. The last program we had,
well-read people.
Well-read people were there, like very, you know, very, you know, fantastic people. And so it gives me hope that we can do well in Cuba before it gets highly materialistic, which is destined to be. So I'll do a plug-in for that now for this year. Hey, buddy, come and have a nice experience, you know, some relaxation time, some time to also move ahead. So while we need to relax and we need the balance also, we need to also push Krishna consciousness, you know. And when I say push, I don't mean push it in people's faces, but push it in the culture in such a way that it's very, very attractive and appealing to people, right? So Nirmana, when you first met the Russian devotee, was the first person you ever met?
Tirtha Pavana,
and that was in Woodstock?
St. John,
New Brunswick. And he has these piercing eyes, right? He's he kind of gets through you, like, and he's like, almost like a serpentine, you know, like a cobra was looking at you, mesmerizing, hypnotizing, you know. He had that kind of gift, and then you listen and you got some material, reading material, and that was it. Now you're finished. She's finished now. I mean, looking, right? Finished looking. Krishna's it, you know. Krishna's it. That's Krishna's it, you know. Bhagavad Gita as it.
Yes.
Is like Krishna. This is Krishna, it. Or it could be he, it could be she, and he says his father and mother, but isn't. One of my dear god sisters, who's not, you know, she's her last days, but Yadli, Devi Dasi in Vancouver. I go to see her when I'm seniors home. She was telling us how she was getting interested in Krishna consciousness, but it was a gradual process. And she always understood that God is an it. The it. Does that make sense to you? It. The big it. The big I-T. Not E-T. I-T. The big it. And then someone kindly, you know, I was thinking, met her and presented to her Bhagavad Gita as it is. So this must be it. This has got to be it. And so we know that she became a very dedicated devotee of Krishna. And I first met her in Sankirtan in Calgary. I took some brahmacharis with me. We drove all the way to Calgary in a van. And the devotees from Vancouver also drove all the way through the mountains to Calgary for the stampede. Not to be stampeded, but to stampede. We were there to promote Krishna consciousness. And it was our understanding in those days. We were kind of young and sometimes a little naive and immature, you know. You just work. You're like a soldier out there. It's all about sacrifice, you know. I mean, I remember doing Sankirtans in Elliott Lake. I happened to be alone. My partner couldn't come 1 week, and I drive first thing Monday morning. I was driving early, and I gas up at the corner of Bathurst and St. Clair, where there's no gas station anymore. Mm. And when I go by that corner, where's my gas station? It's being replaced by some high-rise, of course. So then, I made it all the way up north to like a place called Elliott Lake, which was the Iranian capital of the world. And it was a very, very prosperous place. And the sacrifice that me and whoever was with me in those days, we might sleep in the van. I remember going to one particular, it was like a two-story hotel, and I found a little cubbyhole because it was getting too cold in the van. I was trying to save money. I went into a sort of like I could get into the entrance, sort of the back way, and I found a little cubbyhole under the stairs, and I thought, there I could sleep. It was quiet, nobody could bother me. And then in the morning, wake up, do a morning program, and then go out and do our Sankirtan for the day. And we were just trying to save money. But it was fun. Now when you look back at it, I think I was kind of an idiot, and I certainly couldn't do it now. But in those days, you could just curl up and keep kind of warm. And it was all about, you know, kind of like sacrifice. We heard about so many devotees doing incredible things. There was one devotee group that they were in a van, and they slept, they were sleeping also to save money in the van, and they were parked near the beach. And when they woke up in the morning, there was water all around them. The tide had come in. Yeah, so many, you know, things like that. Yeah, it's good it didn't go too far. Like if you went to the Bay of Fundy, you'd be the highest tide in the world is the Bay of Fundy. It's like where she comes from. And, you know, it's a big tourist attraction, right? I remember having some prasadam with one devotee in our van, and we were just we were having wraps, and we're just watching this one seagull sitting there, you know, on the river. It's called the Pettit, you know. I forget. Do you remember the
colorful part?
It's off of Moncton. Pedicodiac. Yeah, Pedicodiac. And the seagull was just sitting on the water like this, and suddenly it just because the tide was coming in, you know, and you know, in no time the tide is like so many feet up in the air like this, you know. We can be swept away. We can also be swept away by Maya, right? If we're not careful. Krishna talks about that in the Bhagavad Gita, that one of your senses, just one of them, just take one. You know, it could be the tongue, it could be eyes, it could be the ears. Oh, I like that sound. And then before you know it, you're in a place where you shouldn't be, and then one thing leads to another and another. So any one of the senses can take you astray. Maya could pull you there. And just like the wind can sweep away, you know, like a boat, a stale boat can take that away. And that's a nice one of the few beautiful images in Bhagavad Gita. There are some nice images in the Gita, the lotus flower, the water, to help us to understand that we are supposed to be like a lotus. Means that the lotus is dry, and even when water comes on it, it doesn't get soaked, right? It doesn't get soaked, it's resilient to the water. So Jesus once said that too. He said, you know, to be in the world, but not of the world. That means you're here in this material world, but you don't get ensnared by it. That's a beautiful image, right? Another image is of the tortoise. The tortoise draws his limbs within his shell. I grew up in southwestern Ontario, near the Thames River. And usually stories are told, yeah, Charles Dickens is reading about the Thames River, written all about the Thames River. But we have our Thames River. We used to live near there. And all kinds of creatures would come and visit us at our house. We had copperhead snakes and garter snakes, and we had snapping turtles, and we had those little painted turtles, cute little things, you know. We had everything coming to our doorstep. It was like, wow, reptile, you know, haven. And I remember, you know, you go to the turtles, it doesn't matter what it's. Snapping turtles were a little bit more, you know, aggressive, but any turtle you go to, you just tap them on their little shell. They withdraw their limbs in their shell. So Krishna gives that example that, you know, we also have to kind of withdraw when Maya gets strong. Stay inside until the coast is clear. Nice image from Bhagavad Gita. Beautiful image. And so we have a few like that. Anyways, getting back to, you know, it. Krishna is the it. We need to explore him. And we've all been, pretty much everybody in this room has been looking for something that they can sink their teeth into, right? And say, I like my teeth to stay there. I don't need to go anywhere else right now. We're a little bit like a lion, you know, as it gets its jaws in there. Or we have like a wolverine. You know the wolverines that we have in Canada? They're a little bit more north. You know how they operate? They just get in there. They'll take on a grizzly bear. They're about this big. They're not that big. They'll take on a grizzly bear. They're fierce. And they have these jaws and they get in there. And they won't let go. They'll take on a whole pack of wolves. Like one will take on a whole pack of wolves. And they have a strong scent. And we have to be like a wolverine in that regard. You know, like, be like a hunter. Get out there. They say when there's snow slides, you know, when they have an avalanche coming down from the mountain, and if there's a moose, he'll suddenly be buried. Because, you know, Justin Trudeau's brother passed away like that.
Yeah.
He got buried by the snow, one of those slides that came down. And so a moose is buried, maybe 10 feet of snow above him. A wolverine will come around, sniff him out, and search him out, and get in there and get right down to the bones. So in one sense, we have to be a little bit like that, like a wolverine. Just kind of get in there in Maya's world and get to the heart of the people and encourage them in Krishna consciousness with spiritual life. We have to be very determined that way. And we have to think a little bit like Prabhupada did. Said, I have made you fortunate, now you make other people fortunate. That's the deal. We make deals. They're spiritual deals. It's not to do with money so much. It's more to do with what you did for me. Okay, I'll do something in exchange. That's Prabhupada's mandate. Now, we all know that he did pass away in 77, and that would make it how many years? 49 years.
39.
Yeah, right. So, and now this year would make it a little bit more. So we've been in our building since 76, And so, on Avenue Road, it's our anniversary, it was last year, 2016, and now it'll be 41, so it's been a while. But we still have the same mandate, nothing's changed. And that mandate is share Krishna consciousness, give Krishna out to everybody else. And how we do that, it has a lot to do with our presentation. Our presentation doesn't always have to be a super slick, let's say, something on the screen. It can be. But our presentation has to be ourselves. How we behave, how we come on to people, how we are, let's say, how we demonstrate the 26 qualities of a good human being, as described in the 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. People then will say, oh, these Krishnas, they're really very special people. They smile, they're happy, they take care of each other, they're caring kind of people, they're polite, they're full of the law of the land, all those kind of good things that represent a good citizen, and even better than just being a good citizen, going out of our way to, you know, to be nice to people. And those are the kind of things that attract people to Krishna consciousness. What turns people off is that when we don't demonstrate that particular behavior, like, first of all, we want to surely demonstrate that we can get along with each other, that we like each other. Maybe we should slide where there's the crowds are really coming in a big, thick way. Let's get a nice big kachori, you know, packed solid with, you know, pretend this is the outer kachori and you're the inner part of the kachori, make it nice and rich.
Mataji, you're still, yeah, just come on.
Okay, it's taking a yoga to get it all settled in. Okay. So when we demonstrate that we don't get along, or we're arguing, of course, that's human nature, there's going to be disagreements. You know? But everything, we want to minimize that. We just want to minimize the disagreements. You know? So it is a new year for us, and this is a good resolution to start on. Let's try to move along, get along. There's a lot of projects that we have before us. For instance, we'd like to get a nice center, we'd like to secure a nice building in downtown Brampton. We have so many things that we're trying to do, and that just requires some cooperation. And that's always that. Bhakti means just cooperating with Krishna. That's what it means. It's a real simple definition. Just get along with Krishna. And how do we know that we're getting along with Krishna? How can you tell? Krishna's pleased with, you know, with what you're doing. How do we know? Is there some, is there a barometer for that? Mm-hmm. Is there a barometer for this at all? Does anybody have an idea what that might, how do you know if you're pleasing Krishna?
Paramatma.
Paramatma?
From your heart.
Okay, so it's Paramatma will talk to us, call us on the cell phone, or just the little voice.
Okay. Inner voice.
Inner voice? Okay.
Yes, Maharaj, if you're pleasing your spiritual master.
Good. This is one way to know if you're pleasing Guru and you're pleasing the disciplic succession. This is one sure way to gauge that, you know, Krishna's being pleased. Otherwise, how can we really tell, you know?
Inner happiness.
The inner happiness, you become satisfied inside. That's a, let's say, a gauge that, yeah, maybe something's going right. Yeah, sure, that's fine. Anything else? When the prasadam is good, maybe there's a good thing. When tulsi, sometimes devotees say, when the tulsi plant is growing really nice,
yeah,
that means that your devotion is really strong. But if she doesn't do very well, then well, sometimes it is material, you know, physical conditions that doesn't allow that to happen. But we do have to look for those kind of gauges. You know. some that kind of criteria for knowing whether Krishna is pleased. Krishna also tells us, you know, offer to me with love and devotion a leaf, a flower, fruit, or water, and I will accept it. So if we're following his directives, then, you know, he must be pleased, right? And right now, if you look outside of Bhagavat's house here, we've got lots of snow here, Prabhu. Lots of nice white snow. I don't even see any tracks, you know. I had no raccoon game here recently, you know. So it's pretty clean, you know. So even snow is a very pure element, you know. That could be, if you don't have anything else, at least. I used to think about this line from chapter 9. Well, how do the Eskimos do it? How do the Inuits do it? No leaf, no flower. Definitely no flower, no fruit. Water's all frozen. How are they going to please Krishna? Well, you can take pure snow and offer it to Krishna. You know, it's a transformation of water. So there's nothing lacking in terms of our being able to please Krishna in some way, shape, or form. It's always there. Whatever we have. And then ultimately we have our bodies to give. You say, Krishna, from this day on I am yours. This is Hanuman's sentiment. Hanuman's saying to Ram, from this day on I'm yours. You know, I surrender to you. I give every body, mind, intelligence, words, the soul. Perhaps you've seen some of our sannyasis, they take the danda.
Yeah.
I have a danda. I don't use it very often. Once in a while people ask me, where's your danda? I said, well, I've got all my props for the drama. I can't take any more props. It's not working out. I got this and that. And she said, one time we took like two trains, like practically with little rollers, and we took it all the way to Delhi and Calcutta, and every time it came off the plane, what's going to happen? Like, with all our props inside. So anyways, if you take that danda, is like a stick. It's four bamboo rods inside, thin bamboo rods, and then it's wrapped with a cloth, a saffron cloth. And the four rods represent surrender of body, mind, words, and finally the jiva, the soul. So that's what's supposed to be given up in the service of the Lord. So that's what we're meant for. We're meant to give our very selves, our very beings, up to the divine person, Lord Shri Krishna. So in our little reading here, we are seeing that Prabhupada is making those kind of statements, you know, it's everything's for you, Krishna. And and before we depart, we act in such a way that it's always for Krishna. We're talking about family members here, people with families, and you know, and they're not your children. By the way, what? They don't belong to you. What? And like now we're looking at the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Narada Muni, he is speaking to Pariksit Maharaj, and you have to consider who your body really belongs to. It's almost like this is echoed later on in the Bhagavatam, by Yudhishthira Maharaj, after the Kurukshetra War, considering about looking at all the bodies that are lame, you know, after being slain. And the consideration is this. Here's the consideration. Who does your body really belong to? Does it belong to your father, who initiated the whole thing? Does it belong to your mother, who took care of you in the womb and beyond? Does the body belong to your employer? Like, I think if you spend... Anybody here been to China? Nobody's been to China? Okay, I'm not saying you have to go there. It's not necessarily a tirtha, you know, holy place of pilgrimage, but a lot of people there, they're just so reverential towards their employer because on the basis of what he's able to provide employment, therefore, I belong to you. It's almost like I surrender to, and they have like, some people have a puja, you know, for their employer. Mm-hmm. It's a big deal. And then, this is another consideration. Let's say if you're a slave and you're bought by someone, and you belong to that person, that's another consideration. So, Or do you belong to your children because you're doing everything for them? That seems to be like, you know, everything's okay. You can belong to anybody, but not to yourself. You don't even have yourself. You're sold out to a system. You're sold out to other people, other concerns. So in the end, really, though, our bodies are meant for Krishna. So does anybody remember the pastime? And then Chaitanya Leela was one particular devotee who had a kind of a disease. He went through the jungle and he got contracted a disease where it was like a heavy rashes and it was so wretched. I think it was, I haven't gone through the jungles in India, but I just can tell you what poison ivy is all about. And it's not very pleasant. But does anybody remember the name of the
devotee? Satsang Brampton.
Satsang Brampton. And Satsang Brampton, he felt so wretched. He was there for the Rath Yatra. He said, you know, I can't handle this, my body with so much in agony, so much in pain. I think it's time for me to give up my life. And when Jagannath's chariot rolls around, I'm going to throw myself before that cart. And then when that happens, I'll get moksha, I'll get some kind of deliverance. So news traveled to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, and that this was the plan. And when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then heard about it, and immediately he dashed over, he didn't waste any time, there's no procrastination whatsoever. He went to Sanatana Goswami and said, what's this thing about that you're thinking about giving up your life? Don't you know that your body doesn't belong to you? It belongs to Jagannath. And it belongs to the Lord, to Krishna. And so you're not in a position to do with it whatever you like. It's just not yours. That's all. Simple. But let the truth be told. Body doesn't belong to us. It belongs to Krishna. And of course the body is a tool. It's a piece of machinery. We're meant to use it just like you bring your... Everybody came here in a vehicle. Unless if I'm mistaken, any walkers that came down? One of the first Prabhus. Bruce, did you walk down here? I thought I saw you walk down. You parked your car a block away. And I thought I had a walking partner now. So we depend on machinery to get things done. You're making a smoothie. You know, you have to have a blender, right? What else? The way most of us live. Our job, our salary, our security depends on the internet, pretty much, isn't it? For most people, is that true?
Mm.
Isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, up to here, sort of halfway there. Okay. We're so dependent on the machinery everywhere. And you're all tools. And Krishna's telling Arjuna, Savyasachin, he says, you know, you are an expert archer. You use the bow and arrow. They're like your instruments. So he says, Savyasachin, you know, just that means, you know, you're good at archery. And so can you now also be the archer? Or mean, be the instrument, rather? Like Francis of Assisi, he said, let me be an instrument of thy peace. Let me be an instrument, an agent. Not the subject or the object. Let me be the in-between, the middleman. That's what is required of us. Let me be a tool. Let me be a hammer. It's like we should be able to say, Krishna, I'm your hammer. Krishna, I'm your wrench. What else? Well, I'm just an instrument. That's it. That's the way we should be seeing. We have a harmonium here. A harmonium played by Dina Grati, who does a good job. And it's an instrument to be used in Krishna service. And it's used so well. It was invented in Germany in the 1800s. Germans don't use it anymore. The Vaishnavas took it up. And they're doing a good job with it. You go to Germany, you won't see one harmonium practically. But you go by in India, they're all over the place. India, Germany, they got this love affair going on. The claim is that the Germans are the Aryans, and somewhere they came up into the north, and that's the theory, but no one's ever been able to prove it. So there's some cultural links there. But anyways, things are to be used in Krishna service. The hand, kopal. Everybody knows kopal. He's a new arrival. No, he didn't come out of the womb the other day. He's a new arrival from India, and he's a student at Centennial. And he's with us.
Yay!
And have you seen him play the mridanga? It's like, he goes so fast. So where did your hand go? And, there's this limb, and then suddenly this part, it's gone. This exists. That's how fast he is. We're happy to have you. Stick around. This is your family. Make you feel at home. So anyways, the message here is, again, it's a new year. It's a new way of looking at things. It's a new start. Look at some of the things you have to work on, some of the anomalies, some of the shortcomings, address them, do something about it, get absorbed, get more absorbed in Krishna service. And the main point is, let's get along nicely with each other. And we took our ideas and our inspiration from this book, The Ocean of Mercy, by Bhakti Chira Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you. I think we still have room for sliding. Me, my Nita, you look so uncomfortable standing. Why don't you come on in? We have so much space. Always room for you. Such a nice gathering of people, and I feel totally like I'm in India here. It's getting hot. There's lots of room. Okay, good. Do you want to do some more kirtan? What else would you have us do, Bhagavat Prabhu? More kirtan?
Yeah, 15 minutes.
Okay, great. And then?
Then prasadam time.
Chow time, right? Everyone came in time for a chow. Hey, everybody, have a good, happy new year so far?
Yes.
It was pretty okay. Thank you for those of you who came. You probably went to Brampton. Most Bramptonites we have here, right? Some of you came to the Toronto Temple. So I know you're all just a bunch of party animals. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare 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 Hare
Krishna 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 Hare Hare Hare
Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Hare, Hare Hare, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare,
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama,
Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Five what, Prabhu?
Okay.
I mean, I released this garland.
That's right.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much,
Maharaj. Let's give some honor to a real nice family here. Bhagavat, Prabhu, and Krishna Smaran. They're real smooth. Let's hear it, Prabhu. Let's hear it, Prabhu. This is your first kirtan in the house. There will be many more, right? So we have successfully shooed out all the ghosts that are here, and except for me. Now go. Thank you very much. Happy New Year. And speech, I guess.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much for all the devotees to come here to join the program and your association. Thank you again. And a big round of applause to Bhaktimarg Swami and thank you. And somebody has to do this. And Subhavilas Prabhu.
Just one comment about the number 22. Srila Prabhupada did two programs in Toronto, only two house programs, in 1975, one in 1976. And both of them were number 22. Medina Crescent in Scarborough. So that was the number 22. So that reminded me of 22. And the other comment, I got a 1 minute comment.
Maharaj, mother,
he sacrificed Maharaj and his broke day, sleeping in the trucks, shaking bars, saving every dollar, every penny. It's unbelievable. He came in 76, somebody complained that there are too many devotees are living at 243 Avenue Road. So the inspector comes and they come and they make a report. Nobody living there. There's no TV, there's no beds, and no sofas. Everybody used to be calling. We used to have sleeping bags in those days, just this sleeping bag. They say, oh, there's nobody living there. Of course, 100 devotees are living there. So that reminds of Maharaj. A lot of sacrifice Maharaj did. Got arrested, got pushed out, all kind of stuff.
Fun.
So the good old days, fun.
Those were the days, my friend, we thought they'd never end.
Mahaprasade Govinde.
Mahaprasade Govinde.
Namo Brahmane Vaishnave.
Namo Brahmane Vaishnave.
Shalpa Punyavatam Rajan.
Shalpa Punyavatam Rajan.
Vishwasanu Vajayate.
Vishwasanu Vajayate.
Sharira Vidyaja.
Sharira Vidyaja.
Narendriye Tahika.
Narendriye Tahika.
Jive Phele Vishay Sagure.
Jive Phele Vishay Sagure.
Taramati Jivati.
Taramati Jivati.
Lobhumaya Sudurmati.
Lobhumaya Sudurmati.
Kake Jetha Kathir Samsare.
Kake Jetha Kathir Samsare.
Krishna Bada Dayamo.
Krishna Bada Dayamo.
Gori Bari Jivajo.
Gori Bari Jivajo.
Svaprasadana Dilobha.
Svaprasadana Dilobha.
Sayanam Ritupa.
Sayanam Ritupa.
Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gunga.
Sri Radha Krishna Gunga.
premida ko chaitanya nita
premida ko chaitanya nita
jani mai janita
jani mai janita
jai shri krishna chaitanya
jai shri krishna chaitanya
prabhu nityananda
prabhu nityananda
shri advaita gadadha
shri advaita gadadha
shri vasadi gaur bhakta vrinda
shri vasadi gaur bhakta vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Shri Krishna Mahaprasadam ki
jai.
I would like to make another statement.
Aditi, you want to say something?
It's just unfortunate that we were able to celebrate this day with you all. We will always hold you close to our hearts. We will remember today very fondly as we hope to share many more wonderful celebratory milestones with you. Thank you very much for attending our program, and we hope to see you again very soon. And we wish you all a happy new year.
Just to start off the new year on a good note, if you feel like you had a little bit of a rough time with somebody that you shouldn't have had a rough time with in the last year or so, maybe just go to that person and say, let's start fresh, you know. Just let bygones be bygones. And, starting fresh, not getting clean slate is the idea, you know. And maybe you might approach somebody and they're not aware that there was something, you know, like percolating that was maybe not so good. Now they'll find out. But I mean, just take that little time, whether knowingly or unknowingly you offended someone, to just say, listen, forgive me for any offenses I've committed, and let's move ahead with Prabhupada's project and charge forward, you know, against the army of Maya. Okay, what do you say?
Hi, Bob.
Hamsa, what do you say about that one?
Okay, you're not Hamsa, are you? I'm just talking about this guy here. He's making a statement. That's a statement. What did I say? Thank you very much. Okay, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.